without you. We won't move without you. You're the light of all and all that we need. We won't move without you. We won't move without you. You're the light of all and all that we need. We won't move without you. Take a seat. All right. Boy, that was, I enjoyed that. I'm glad that you all sang along, and it was, I loved it. We'd like to, this morning, we have a special guest. We'd like to welcome Bishop Yembasu from Sierra Leone, and I've already heard part of what he has to say. He has a special word from the Lord this morning, and he's going to share it with us. Yeah, I want to give him a hand of applause for just for traveling a couple of miles to get here. I've made that trip, not from Africa to here. It's a long one. The jam meal on Wednesday is at Parkview this week, so don't come here. Go to Parkview. And this is a weird announcement. There's no adult respect class this week. I have no idea what that even means. And then be sure to support the Woodlawn movie on Friday if you get the chance. It's coming to Milbank. If you can't go Friday, it must be on Saturday. But what I'd love to see is a great turnout here and show the movie theater that, yes, if there's a good movie, people will show up. And they will show up from the churches. So, I've seen the previews. We played them here. And it sounds really good. It sounds like the Titans movie meeting the Facing the Giants movie or something like that, maybe even better. So be sure and check that out. And that's it.
Want to invite you all to stand up and greet your neighbor and pass the peace of Christ.
Thanks, Jeremy. That's okay. We didn't tell Jeremy we've been doing this at the end now, but so we're going to do it twice this morning, which is all the better. You can meet different people every time if you want. Let's continue in worship.
There's nothing worth more that will ever come close. Nothing can compare your unliving hope. Your presence, Lord. tasted and seen of the sweetest of loves. There my heart becomes free and my shame is undone. Your presence, Holy Spirit, you are welcome here. Come flood this place and fill the atmosphere. Your glory, God, is what our hearts long for. To be overcome by your presence, Lord. Your presence, Lord. There's nothing worth more than of loves, when my heart becomes free and my shame is undone. Your presence, Lord. Holy Spirit, you are welcome. Come flood this place and
song, and I love it, so we have to do it. Yes. Sorry, I just jumped the gun. That was such a nice place, but let's keep going. Oh, please stand again. We can't skip this song.
Let it be, Jesus. abandoned? Should I ever be acclaimed? Should I ever be surrounded by the fire and the flame? There's a name I will remember. There's a name I will proclaim. Let it be, let it be. God, I bring your name above everything. Let it be, Jesus.
Amen.
You may be seated.
Amen. This morning's scripture lesson comes from the Gospel of Mark, chapter 4, verses 35 through 41. On that day, when evening had come, he said to them, "Let us go across to the other side." And leaving the crowd behind, they took him with them in the boat, just as he was. Other boats were with him. A great windstorm arose, and the waves beat into the boat so that the boat was already being swamped. But he was in the stern, asleep on the cushion. And they woke him up and said to him, "Teacher, do you not care that we are perishing?" He woke up, rebuked the wind, and said to the sea, "Peace, be still." Then the wind ceased, and there was a dead calm. He said to them, "Why are you afraid? Have you still no faith?" And they are filled with great awe and said to one another, "Who then is this that even the wind and the sea obey him?" Here ends the reading of God's holy word. I'd like to invite the children to come up for a couple of minutes. Good morning. How's everybody doing this morning? Good? Good. Okay. So, Jesus and his disciples have been hard at work, very busy. Jesus tells them, "Hey, let's get in the boat, and we're going to go over to the other side of the lake." Good morning, ladies. We're going to go over to the other side of the lake. So they get in the boat, and they start rowing over, and Jesus decides he needs a nap, and he falls asleep in the boat, and he must have been sleeping really hard. Now, we don't know if Jesus snored. I'm going to guess maybe he did sometimes. Is that a weird thing to think, that maybe Jesus snored? Everybody snores? Yeah? And your mom snores? Yeah, okay. Yeah, we don't know if Jesus was snoring, but we do know he was sleeping really, really hard because a storm came up. There's waves crashing over the boat. The wind was just pushing the boat all over the place. And Jesus just laid there and slept away. His disciples got scared. His first 12 disciples, they were scared. So they go over to Jesus and they wake Jesus up and they say, Jesus, we're going to drown. Don't you care? Do something. So Jesus gets up and he calms the storm and completely stops it. It's done. And he asks his disciples, he says, why are you guys afraid? Don't you trust me? Don't you have faith? Now, when we hear that story, what we hear for us is that, you know, there's times when life is hard, right? Right? Are there times we get in trouble or bad things happen? Right? Those are storms. We call those storms of life. And so it may not be a storm like a thunderstorm or anything, but it's a difficult time, right? We have hard times. We have times that make us sad. And Jesus wanted his disciples to know that even in those storms, he's there. He's with us. He's always with us. He's not only with us during the good things, but even in the bad things. When we're hurt, when we're sad, Jesus is there. And he'll always be there. All we have to do is trust him. We won't physically see him, but we'll know he's present with us. We just have to trust. Okay? Let's pray. Loving God, Lord, we thank you so much for Jesus. And we thank you for all of us being reminded that Jesus isn't just there in the good times, but in those hard times too, in those sad times. He's always present. It's in his name that we pray. Amen. Okay, ladies first. You want a sucker, ladies? Ladies? Gentlemen? Thank you. You can go back now. It is my honor and privilege that Bishop Yamasu is here with us today. We had a wonderful conversation this morning before even the first service, and getting to know each other a little bit. I know some of you probably already know him. He was here a couple years ago, but it's my first time to meet Bishop Yamasu, and very excited to hear him preach for the third time. As pastors, when you preach a message, it's not always the same. You can write it out, but you go from one service to the next, and it morphs and it changes. And I've heard two different sermons this morning already. It's basically the same message, though, but interesting, very interesting. New twists in both of those. So I'm anxious to hear what you have to share with us this afternoon. So as Bishop Yamasu comes forward, let's give him a hand, okay?
Amen and good afternoon. I think you already know that here, and that's what we do whenever we meet for worship or gatherings as a church. The pastor always begins by saying, God is good, and you respond all the time. You know that already here, not so? Why don't we try it? God is good?
All the time?
All the time? Wonderful. And just about the time when Ebola was gliding off, when about 4,000 people died in Sierra Leone, and the survivors will meet and worship, it took a different tone. And those that survived Ebola, we always have this to say. When the pastor says, God is good, they say all the time, and the pastor says all the time, they will respond by saying, I am a living witness. We that survived Ebola, we are a living witness to the goodness of God. And it is that goodness of God that really has brought me here. And I was, each time I come here, I've been here, this is my second time, but on both occasions, it's always not really been the same. In 2014 or so, when I came, the pews were all very straight. You remember that? They were really straight. And then this time I have come, it's like a little bit slanting. So that gives opportunity to everybody to really focus, you know, on the pastor here. So I bring you greetings from your brothers and sisters on the other side of the Atlantic Ocean, where we have been battling with Ebola, but thank God for his goodness and mercy. It's almost over now. We're running just about some 24 more days, and the country will be declared Ebola free, and people will continue to go back, you know, to normal life again. It's been a very gruesome experience. It's been painful. The journey has been long, but we thank God. We lost about roughly 4,000 people to Ebola. And I have come here specifically to say thank you, to express the gratitude of the Sierra Leonean people to you people, you know, here, to Central United Methodist Church, for just being there when you were really needed the most. When Ebola broke out, almost all of the hospitals in the country, including government health centers, were all closed down, because those churches, those health facilities depended on the income, the resources from the patients to run the hospitals, but then no patient was going to the hospital, no salaries, government hospitals went on strike from day to day. But thank God, 6 of our 10 health facilities in the country, United Methodist, remain open throughout Ebola, including the Lower and Rutgers Eye Hospital, which is the Kissy Eye Hospital, which you people have been supporting over the last many years. But for your donations, that hospital will also have closed down, and poor people, blind, will have gone without new glasses, without new eyes. But your donations that went there through the Reiners and through Dr. Guest were used to do surgery, to remove cataract. And so a host of people really benefited even in the midst of crisis. So thank you so very much. Thank you, and thank you. It's always been joy for me to be here, and I want to be particularly grateful and thankful to Roger and Milani. They have always opened their doors to me, and I find myself so comfortable being with them every time I'm here. Yesterday, I was telling them, you know, they have so much spoiled me with food. I eat 3 times a day. I don't eat 3 times a day in Sierra Leone. And so I said to them yesterday, you know what? It's going to be different when I get back. And there are times we eat breakfast, and in between breakfast and lunch, there are some snacks. Bishop, what about this? And then we eat that, and then we eat lunch, and in between lunch and dinner, we got that, and after dinner, there is supper. You eating every day. But I really want to thank God for his love and mercy and his grace. And I thank you all so much. We had a short meeting. I was privileged to meet with Pastor Tom and his leadership team this morning as we prepare for worship. And as I always do, I asked, you know, when I visit churches here, I asked him, how long, Pastor, do you think my sermon must last? He says, well, Bishop, I'm sorry, but just 15 minutes. And I said, well, I will try. Because actually, for those of you who've been to Africa, 15 minutes is just when we're about done with our introduction to the message. We have not even preached yet. It's just the introduction, 15 minutes. Because we are in church for 3, 4, or 5 hours as the Holy Spirit leads. And so, Pastor Tom, I want to remain faithful to that. I will try in 15 minutes. But if I go beyond that, then don't hold me responsible. It's the power of the Holy Spirit at work. We want to spend a couple of time to just a few minutes to talk on the theme, on the other side. On the other side. And I want to begin with a simple question, and honestly, I don't deserve an answer to that question. But suppose when you came here this afternoon, ready for worship, leaving behind everything, and you came to church, and Pastor Tom stands here and says to you, hey, church, I apologize. I'm so sorry. We're not going to worship this morning. No worship service. You know, we have there's a neighborhood there over there, and we have a neighbor whose roof was blown off last night. He needs shelter, and we need to go there. The question is, what would be your response? I don't know, but I know there will be many, many questions. And some of you might begin to say, well, Bishop Trump, but that's not in the bulletin. We came for worship. And in fact, we are not really in the right gear. We don't have the right type of clothing for that. It's an outdoor, and it's chilly out there. Or some of you may say, it's so warm. We're just not ready for that. So we can't go. Well, if we went there, how long is it going to take us to go? We didn't even bring tools with us. We have no tools. How are you going to think we're going to help them? But the good thing, my friends, about the passage that Pastor Tom so eloquently read is the fact that when Jesus said this to his disciples, they never asked a question, not a word. Nobody said a word. And you see, the incident here happened in the evening, and the Bible says Jesus and his disciples have been out the whole day ministering to people. So they were really tired and worn out. And the best any good American would do that evening was to take a cup of Starbucks coffee and go to bed. But then, once Jesus said, let's go over, and it was in the evening, a very obscure time of the day to go out into the boat at night. What's the agenda? What are we going to do? So they jumped into this boat and off they went, trusting this Master Jesus who has called us as the one who will lead the way, as the one who will take care of the agenda. Because they have lived with him for quite a while and they have seen his capabilities and what he was doing and what he could do in a very obscure situations. And so they trusted him. Do we trust this Jesus, friends, as we come to church Sunday by Sunday? And so they jump into the boat, but St. Mark says almost somewhere, about midway into the lake, a heavy wind broke out. My friends, there are times when you think you're so comfortable, when you think when all is right with you, that's when the devil shows his ugly head. When you think your family life is all that good, when you think your job is okay, your relationship is working okay, that's when the devil shows its ugly head. They were comfortable in that boat. And the Bible says that Jesus Christ was sleeping on a cushion. So it was all happy clappy. But then Satan came in. The squall broke out. And the Bible says that their boat was about to sink. It was tossing up and down. And there was nothing they could do. But I thank God for the life of these disciples. They knew who called them. They knew who was in the boat with them. And so when the disaster happened, when the crisis was about to happen, they knew exactly whom to go to. And I don't know who actually initiated that. But knowing Peter as I do, the most outspoken of those disciples, I know he certainly must have been the one that said, let's wake him up. Let's wake him up. We must share this 50-50. After he's the one that brought us in. Let's wake him up. And true, they woke him up. And as usual, in his usual calmness of treating situations, of responding to situations, in his authoritative manner as God of nature, who has control, who is the creator himself, who was and is and will ever be, he stood up and said to the storm, be still. Peace. Be still. And Spemax says, and there was calm. Is it interesting how sometimes and even often how Christ comes into our tumultuous situations and just calm the storms of our life? But I will be talking about that a little bit, no, in a very short time. But what I want to really focus here is that more often we are afraid to go over on the other side. We are afraid to go over on the other side because of so many, many, many fears. Going on the other side in the first place is one of the most uncomfortable things to do. I know some of you may have experienced it. Those who have left here to go to Africa or to go to Sierra Leone and Zimbabwe and somewhere else, you know how sometimes it's so uncomfortable. The time you spend packing up, taking the right tools and sometimes wondering, what am I really going to do there? How am I going to be accepted? It's so uncomfortable because it also means sometimes leaving your families, your comfort zones, leaving friends behind, your status quo. It may also mean giving up the ease and the pleasantries and the pleasures to which you have become so conditioned in your situation that you just don't want to move out. And I'm sure if Jesus has asked these disciples at that time of the evening, some of them may have said, no, Jesus, we're tired. But thank God, when this master really wants to enter into our lives, he doesn't ask for our permission. Amen. He really doesn't ask. When Jesus really wants to enter into your life, he needs not your permission. Because after all, he owns the life and he just comes in there. And so he says, get out. We must go. There's times, friends, we are afraid of the troubles and the dangers that we may not be able to handle or deal with. It may mean dealing with people who are not like us. Racism and xenophobia, one of those things that make us so much afraid to deal with one another. And that has now actually taken over our world. We're afraid of the challenges that we might meet. Maybe exposure to diseases like malaria, diarrhea, and typhoid. And perhaps in my own case, coming from Sierra Leone, West Africa, Ebola. You don't want to deal with that. It may be dealing with situations that you've always taken for granted. And you go there, it's not there. No electricity. I was saying that I come to this country each time and there are certain places you go, you just open the door without touching a switch and light comes on. You move out and light goes off. And there are times you take your cell phone and you just talk to it and it is calling people, dialing people automatically. And you go to on the other side, those may not be there. Some of us have very comfortable Starbucks. Suddenly you go, or pizza, and you're going to part with pizza or Starbucks for about 2-3 weeks. It's uncomfortable, friends. But these are the uncomfortable things that Christ called us to do because he himself took the initiative by making himself uncomfortable when he moved from heaven down to earth. He needn't have done that. But he did it for my sake and for your sake. And coming down on earth, he had no business, friends, dying upon the cross. But he chose the way of the cross. It's uncomfortable, it's painful. And I remember, you all know, at one point in scripture, he said, my God, why have you forsaken me? That is painful, it's uncomfortable. But then he chose the way of the cross that you and me might receive salvation. And I heard him saying to his disciples, if therefore I, your master, could wash your feet, you also need to wash one another's feet. If Christ lived and died for us, if Christ came from that side to this side to minister to us, we also ought to do it to others. Friends, going on the other side may sometimes expose us to challenges so huge that we become completely helpless, thinking they may overpower us. Yes, of course, our boat may hit an iceberg or a rock, or we may suddenly find ourselves in the middle of nowhere with no one seemingly to help. But let me share this secret with you. In the midst of your trouble, the one who calls you. In the midst of your pain and anguish, he who calls you, or him who you call by his name, Christian, Christ, is there with you in the boat. What Christ never promises followers is bed of roses. He didn't say you are immune to troubles and trials and temptations. He didn't say you are immune to sickness or diseases. But he says in the midst of your disease, in the midst of your sickness, in the midst of your trouble, I am there with you. Always. He did not say sometimes. He says always. What the glory that we have a God who is there with us always. There are situations back home when you are in the feet of a circumstance, in the middle of a sickness, that even your friends, your parents, get fed up with you. But Christ is there always, even on to the end of the ages. The disciples were afraid and terrified for one reason, because what they did was that they really focused their eyes not on the man in the boat who caught them, but they focused their minds and hearts on the enormity of the storm. They totally forgot that we have a master that has an enormous power to just calm the storm. And it happens in our daily lives. Our life is running backside, and instead of us running to him who can fix it for us, we say, I can fix it. Our families are running in running way out, and we say, I can fix it. There are times we're battling with so many diseases or whatever it is, painful circumstances, and we say, we can fix it. And I said here this morning that serially, the United Methodist Church has just found itself in this same situation. Wherever you go, it's about homosexuality. It's about who is right and who is wrong. And instead of the church, this issue is so much tearing the church apart. And United Methodism stands at the brink of collapse. We want to fix it ourselves, and we want to legislate it. We think that legislation will be the answer. We have not come to the point where every United Methodist will say, can we go to the throne of grace and we all just kneel there and say, God, take control. Because he is there in this boat with us. Christ will calm the storms of our life if we only take it to him. Friends, if just read this text and just stop at Mark chapter 35, you are tempted to say, oh, what a glorious story. What a beautiful story. That there was a storm in the life of the disciples and their master Jesus just calmed in, and from now on it's going to be ease. It's going to be beautiful. It's going to be beds of roses. But that's not the end of that story. If you go further to chapter 5, Mark says that as soon as Jesus and his disciples got out of the boat on that other side, they were met with a demon-possessed man who did everything to block their way and bring their ministry almost to an end that day. But again, as Jesus will always respond to situations in his usual calmness, he engaged that man who was possessed by demons. He asked him, what is your name? There are times you really live with people and you don't even know their name. I was saying here this morning that we come to church Sunday after Sunday. The pastor preaches beautiful, wonderful sermons. You hear scripture reading. The choir sing wonderful songs. And at the end, you go out without even bothering to ask the next man who was with you in the pew, what is your name? And so we come to church Sunday after Sunday. You don't even know how many people you worship with in the church by name. That's how Jesus will start conversations. And you really never would have such a conversation without you knowing the name. So the man said, I am Legion. But I tell you, that was not his real name. It was a name that was given to him by his circumstance and by society. Just because they don't want to deal with him, they gave him a name that will demonize him, that will make him separate. And when you read scriptures, especially in the New Testament, there are several of such names, misplaced identities. The man with the issue of blood, blind Bartimaeus, the man born blind, the man at the beautiful gate, the bent over woman, etc., etc. There are so many of those. That was not their real names. But these are names that have been given to them by a selfish and insensitive world that just do not want to have any part to do with them. On Friday, I came over at New York, you know, JFK Airport. And the immigration officer took my passport and he looked at it and said, "You're coming from the Ebola country." And I said, "No, sir." He said, "Where are you coming from?" I said, "Sierra Leone." He said, "Yeah, but that's an Ebola country." I said, "No, sir. The name of the country is Sierra Leone." He is given the name Ebola country because of our circumstance. And that's not our identity. That is just the country's name, Sierra Leone. And that's what we do every day. You meet somebody by the street, that's a beggar. The beggar has a name, a God-given name that makes him human. And the moment you ask his name, it makes a difference not only in the life of that man, but in your own life too. Because for the first time, somebody is asking his name. And that was how what this man actually felt. For the first time maybe in his life, some stranger is asking his name, a Jew for that matter. And he says, "My name is Legion." How beautiful it will be. We go to the restaurant sometimes, hey, hello. You sit at table with somebody and you eat a meal with that person, you don't even know his name. What is your name? And that was the beginning of the discussion, and it made a whole lot of difference in the life of that man. But look at that. St. Mark gives a very vivid description of this man. He says that he lived in tombs, and he was perpetually bound in chains and hands and feet, so he could not even move. His total freedom was seized. He is already possessed by demons. And instead of the people helping him, society banned him. And so he could not even move and has no freedom. He cried day and night for help, but no one listened to his cries. Friends, the church is called to reach out to people on the other side of life. People who are not like us. They are people who have been possessed by the demons of poverty and diseases. There are people who have been possessed by the demons of war and natural disaster, illiteracy, and terrorist political systems. Their lives have been battered, and they wander about as though they were mere strangers in this planet. Their hands and feet have been bound in chains by the evil forces and systems in our world to the extent that they cannot do anything to set themselves free. And they live perpetually in tombs of helplessness and hopelessness and rejection and abandonment. We live in a world where the cries of the needy and the lost call us to attention day by day. But often our response is no different from the response of the Levite and the priest in the story of the Good Samaritan. Instead of helping this poor, helpless man, they pass by on the other side. We don't want anything to do with them. We're too busy to deal with them. Today, the United Methodist Church is becoming more and more capitalistic each day. Rather than moving inside out, we move outside in. We become encapsulated. We have become encapsulated within the warmth of the four walls of the church building, and we forget what is happening outside its walls. In the 25th chapter of St. Matthew's Gospel, St. Matthew paints a picture of sheep and goats. Some clergy persons preaching on this text, or Bible scholars, have referred to this passage as the Great Judgment. But to me, this text is not really about judgment as much. It is not even about who is up there or who is down, or who is right and who is wrong, or even about who is sheep and who is goat. Rather, the passage paints the picture of a great surprise. It is about the miracle of life in God, the miracle of seeing Christ in one another, the miracle of abundant life for all who receive and for all who give. It is about being faithful to Christ's call to be there for the poor and the needy in our world. It is a call to be in solidarity with those who have been pushed to the margins of life. One of my favorite theologians was a German who died in the concentration camps, you know, in Germany. Dietrich Bonhoeffer. And he says, he makes this very poignant point, and I quote, he says, the church is the church when it lives its lives for others. The church becomes the church when it lives its lives for others. And he was just saying in a different way what John Wesley meant the Methodist church to be. Not as an institution, but as a movement, moving out of itself, multiplying itself, reaching out and bringing others in, attending to the needs of those who are not like us. This miracle, my friends, only happens when we free ourselves of some of the ease and plenty and comfort and go out on the other side. And in the words of Jesus Christ, I invite you, each one of you, let us go on the other side. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Loving, gracious, sovereign God, Lord, we thank you so much for Bishop Yambusu and his message, for him being here, taking time out of his schedule. We do appreciate it. We do pray for him for safe travels back home. We pray for those in Sierra Leone, especially those who may still be impacted by Ebola, which is not just a disease that affects people physically, but it affects people financially, economically, socially, and there's many years ahead where there's going to be some struggles, and so our hearts go out to them and our prayers go out to them as well. Lord, we thank you so much for the bishop's message this morning. Great reminder of, as a church, that Jesus Christ does go with us in our trials and in our struggles, and that Jesus goes with us when we go outside the walls of the church and serve your people. Lord, you know this church is great at that, and we pray that as you continue to bring opportunities to Central, that we would accept those with open arms, as we all have a heart and a desire to be in your will and to be serving your Son, our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. It's in his name that we pray. Amen. Thank you again.
Yes. We're going to take an offering this morning, but be sure that if you're a guest here, we don't expect you to. You know, there's no obligation to put anything in. If this is for us to worship as members of the church, to give the tithes and offerings so that they might be used for the mission of the church. So we're going to do two things at once, too, to make it more complicated. We're going to sing and we're going to take the offering. So we like to put the two together to worship. So please stand with us and worship as we take the offering.
Give thanks to the Lord, our God and King. His love endures forever. For he is good, he is above all things. His love endures forever. Sing praise, sing praise. With a mighty hand and an outstretched arm, his love endures forever. The life that's been reborn, his love endures forever. Sing praise, sing praise, sing praise, sing praise. Forever God is faithful, forever God is faithful. carry on. His love endures forever.
Everybody had the chance to worship here today, and we're going to dismiss you now, but we'd like you to meet and greet those around you, and feel free to hang out a while. If you need prayer, come on up and talk to one of us up front. If you want to worship some more, that's okay, but we'll see you.